Starting from around November of last year, I've had a burden on my heart to preach on tithes and offering, but I've been waiting for a good time to preach on it. And it's not an easy topic to preach on, at least for myself. For me, one of the issues is I am financially supported by the church as a pastor, and so there's always been this stigma of when I preach an offering, I am preaching perhaps for my own self-gain, and I am not, but nevertheless, I always have to overcome that feeling whenever I do preach on this topic. But having said that, tithing is a very important part of a Christian's life, of a Christian's walk, and so it would be amiss for me to avoid teaching on it just because of how I feel or what I think people might think. And so this morning, we're going to be speaking on this topic, and I had spent a good part of the month of January finalizing all the accounting for the church for fiscal year 2017, and I thought, you know, initially, the tax documents are due, I need to turn it into the IRS by January 31st, so maybe the first week of February would be a good time to teach on this. The thought was in the back of my mind, and I was praying and contemplating on it, but hadn't made a decision until Monday evening, this past Monday at Men's Group Bible Study. We were studying the temptations that Jesus faced in the wilderness in Matthew chapter 4, and in the discussion, the topic of tithing came up a few times, and so I thought, okay, Lord, here we go. First week of February, we'll teach on tithing. And so God answered, and so we're going to hear about it this week. Giving. We often sing about giving of ourselves to God, offering ourselves to God. And I think it is a very, very honorable desire to have, right? We all as believers, as Christians, we have been redeemed by God. We belong to God. And so I hope that every one of you comes to a point in your life where you say to yourself, you know what, I belong to God, so I want to give myself back to God. And you're not really giving yourself back to God because you already belong to God. But the way we live and our actual position as having belonged to God are often very different. And so it is my prayer and hope that we will come to a point where we say, you know what, I want my life to be consistent with my position. And it's a nebulous concept though, right? How do you give yourself to the Lord, right? We're not going to build an altar and have each of you come up one at a time and offer yourself to the Lord, because that's against the law, and it would be terrible to be the last person to go. You know, it's such a lonely way. So this is not how we give of ourselves, right? The song that we just sang, Take My Life and Let It Be, it was written by Francis Havergal, and guess what day it was written on? February 4th. It's a happy little happenstance that it happened to be written. I didn't plan it this way. It just so happened this way. Now, 144 years old, this song is. 144 years old, and yet the truth contained in the song still rings so true for us today, does it not? That we would desire to give of ourselves and our lives in every aspect. Now, Frances, she was a sickly woman. She spent most of her life in frail health, and she died at the very tender age of 42. And the genesis of this song was she had been visiting a home. She spent 5 days visiting a home, and there were 10 people living there. Some of those people were not Christians, were not believers, and the others who were Christians, she wrote in her journal, she said they were not rejoicing Christians. And so she visited the home, and she hoped to bring the joy of the Lord and the presence of the Lord to the home. And so she prayed. She prayed when she came to visit. She said, God, give me this whole house. Give me this whole house, that everyone in here would be blessed by you. And in this time that she spent there, before her visit was over, every single person was blessed by the Lord. God answered her prayers. And so she was so happy that her last night there, she couldn't sleep. And she stayed up most of the night. And what did she do? She didn't stay up rejoicing and being happy about what happened. She stayed up saying, Lord, I want to rededicate myself to you. Lord, you are so good. You answered my prayers. You saved these people. I am going to dedicate myself to you again. And so she started writing down, I want to consecrate myself to you, Lord. And as she wrote these things down, it eventually became the lyrics for the song that we just sang. And here's a godly woman, right? A very godly woman, and she's rededicating herself to God. And so because of this, Because of who she is and how she lived her life and her relationship with God, her song ends up naturally being a very, very beautiful exposition on the art of giving oneself to God, right? Of consecrating yourself. And I know I would not have been able to write this song the way it is. Because as much as I try to, I haven't lived my life as well as she has. And so it would behoove us to take a look at the hymn, but unfortunately we don't have a lot of time, right? I had written down a lot of things I want to look at in the hymn, and at the end I looked at the notes and I, knowing how much time we had, and I said, you know what? We don't have time to look at all of the hymn. We'll come back to it another day perhaps. Today though, I do want to call your attention to the second half of verse 2, since we are speaking on giving and tithing. Second half of verse 2, she writes, take my silver and my gold, not a mite would I withhold. Take my intellect and use every power as thou shalt choose. Right? Intellect is something that's hard to put your hand on. Right? And it is not about how smart you are. Right? A lot of times you see the word intellect, and some of us, myself included, when we see the word intellect, we think, well, I'm sorry, Lord, I just don't have any of that. No, it's not about how smart you are. It's whatever capacity you have in your mind, your thoughts, whatever you have in your mind, you give that to the Lord and say, use every power I have as thou shalt choose, is what the psalm says, right? Let my thoughts be for you. But to come back to the line before that, your silver and your gold, that's something tangible, right? When we speak of giving ourselves, when we come to silver and gold, that's tangible. And, you know, okay, so practically speaking today, most of us actually don't really touch our money, right? It's not like Ebenezer Scrooge sitting there counting his piles of coins, right? We've all seen the different movies and adaptations, and who is Donald Duck who plays Ebenezer Scrooge in the Disney adaptation, right? He's sitting there, he's got the piles of coins, and he keeps touching each one. There's a very tactile a sense of my money, I'm counting my money. Right? Today, it's not like that. Today, we sit in front of the browser, right? Refresh, as if, like, once you refresh, you're gonna see your bank account go up or down. Well, if you're checking your stock portfolio, maybe, right? On volatile days, on scary days, you see your stock portfolio go up and down and up and down, and notice it mostly goes down, right? And this you know, I remember when I first started working, when I was first introduced to the world of stocks, our company stock was going crazy. It doubled every 6 months. I remember, you know, calling my brother who was still in college, and I said, hey, Tony, guess what? After the first 6 months, I can buy a new set of tires for my car. The next 6 months, I can buy a new car. The next 6 months, I can put a down payment on my other. Money was, and I was playing this game online called Virtual Stock Exchange, where they give you $10 million, fake money. And you can distribute it however you want in your portfolio. And it was addicting. Right? But when it's money that you don't really have to be responsible for, you can take risk and you can watch that balloon into 100 million because you're taking crazy risks. Anyways, money today is not as tangible, right? It's most of it is electronic. We use credit cards. Many people don't carry cash anymore. Now, what does Francis say about silver and gold, though, coming back to money? She says, not a mite would I withhold. What is a mite? We're not talking about bugs, right? A mite, in the sense that she's using it here, it is a small coin, a Flemish coin, a very small face value. I guess it would be akin to a penny today, right? We've been going to the laundromat because our dryer's broken, and you use a lot of quarters, right? But at the laundromat, I see pennies lying around. People who bring their coins and they use quarters and pennies, people leave it there. Nobody cares to pick up pennies anymore. Right? I pick up pennies because a penny saved is a penny earned. But people don't value pennies. And here, Francis is saying, even a mite, something so small that other people would just disregard, I am not going to withhold that from you, Lord. Right? Okay, so what does it mean to withhold? Right? Ooh. Withhold from whom, right? From God, obviously. I will not withhold a single mite from God. And what does it mean, though? What does it mean to not withhold anything from God? Right? You might say, here, God, I'm going to print out my bank statement and my stock portfolio, and I'm just going to put it right here, God, and I'm not withholding anything from you. Whatever you want to take, go ahead and take it. I'll just sit and wait. Okay, you're not taking anything. Well, okay, I didn't withhold anything from you, but, you know, you didn't want anything, so I guess you don't have any need. I heard this pastor share once on giving, right? The way you give to the Lord is you take out all your cash, and you say, God, I'm ready to give it to you, okay? Let's play catch. Whatever you decide to keep, hold on to it. whatever you don't think you need, just let it land back on the earth. Here we go. And you throw it up, and you know, of course everything falls back down. No, God, you don't have any need. Right? That's not what it means to not withhold from God. Right? Well, so what does it mean? What does it mean to not withhold? Well, what is the point that I'm making here with our silver and gold? Right? It's not just about my attitude toward my money. Because a lot of times we can say, God, I have the right heart, the right attitude toward my money. I'm not going to withhold anything from you. And then we sit and we do nothing with it. Right? We don't take any action. There needs to be action taken to make this particular area, to make that consecration solid. There has to be, I guess what they call it in meetings, there has to be an action item. Right? Something needs to be done. And so I want to examine a little bit today what God says about giving. The very first instance that we see of giving, of tithing in the Bible, comes in Genesis chapter 14. You don't have to turn there, you can if you want, but in Genesis chapter 14, Abram sees his nephew Lot captured by foreign kings, and so he goes to battle. He takes his men, he goes to battle to recover his nephew Lot, and he goes to battle, and he wins, and he takes home his nephew Lot, and the people that were captured, and he was able to bring home spoils of war. Right? So he is victorious. He brings home the spoils of war. And he comes, and upon his return, after his victory, upon his return, he was met by the priest of the Most High God, Melchizedek. And we won't go into too much about who he is today. But what we see is Melchizedek meets Abram, blesses him, and we see in Genesis chapter 14, verse 20, what does Abram do in response? And he gave him, Abram gave Melchizedek a tithe of all, right? What is a tithe? A tithe, literally, the word tithe means a tenth, right? So Abram comes back, he's blessed, and he has spoils of war, money, obviously, and animals, and he gives a tenth of it in response. What's the response here? He understands, Abram understands, that his victory did not come by his own power. His victory came because the Lord blessed him. And in response to this blessing, in response to the Lord keeping his life intact and keeping Lot's life intact, in response to the Lord giving him and blessing him this victory, he understands, right? I believe he was led by the Spirit, because there were no commands given yet about tithes, but he understands, as led by the Spirit, to give a tenth of all that he brought back to Melchizedek as an offering. Right? He understood that this victory was not his own. He understood that the spoils were not his own. Right? And as I said, this response was not a response done out of duty because he was fulfilling a law, because a law had not yet been given. But he understood by the leading of the Spirit to give a tenth of all in recognition of who really won that battle. Right? The next time that we see tithing occurs in Genesis chapter 28. And here, Jacob had just awoken from a vision in which the Lord allowed him to see the angels traversing up and down the stairs from heaven. And Jacob wakes up and he dedicates that place and he names it Bethel. And he promises to God in his prayer and in his dedication, he promises to God that from that point on, whatever God gives him, he will give a tenth. Right? So again, here, not because of a law, not because of a command, but inspired by the Lord, right? Led by the Spirit, his response is, Lord, I know you will take care of me. This was your promise. And in response, I will give a tenth of all that you bless me with. Okay. Now, then, after that, we come to the laws where God commands tithing, or the giving of a tenth of what you have gained. Right? There were three types of tithes that were commanded. The first tithe that was commanded is to bring your tithes to the temple, to the Levites. Because God said the Levites are going to be that one tribe out of 12 who will serve in the temple of the Lord, and they will not have any land. God gave the land of Canaan to all the Israelites, to all of them, except for whom? The tribe of Levites. And so God said, I want the Levites to be mine, to serve in the house of the Lord. They will not have land, and so they will not have sustenance. And so what, are the servants of the Lord going to starve? No, God says, to make this work, the rest of you 11 tribes, bring a tithe of your gains, a tenth of your gains, whatever you grow, whatever your animals produce, whatever you have gained, bring a tenth, And if each of the tribes brings a tenth, then guess what? That's 11 tenths. And they're brought into the temple and is given for the Levites and for the use in the temple so the Levites could sustain themselves, could live, could eat. So this was the first tithe that was commanded. The second tithe that was commanded is you need to bring a tenth of what you have gained to Jerusalem, to the feast, and eat it in joy and gladness and in fear of the Lord, knowing that this was given to you by the Lord. If you didn't have God, you wouldn't have these things. And so God commanded a time off. Think about this. It was mandated vacation. But God did say, if it's too far for you to come to Jerusalem, then do it right where you are. But take this time to gather a tenth of what you have and eat it with this express purpose. Eat it before the Lord and enjoy it and rejoice and know where this came from. Because we forget sometimes, do we not? We continue to live by what the Lord blesses us with, but we forget who it's from sometimes. And so the Lord said, as a reminder to you, so that you don't forget, enjoy what I have given you, but do it purposefully to remember that I gave it to you. The third tithe that was commanded, the third tithe was to be given every third year. And this third tithe that was commanded was to be given for who? For the poor, which includes the Levites and the sojourners or travelers who didn't have their own land, the fatherless and the widows. God said every third year, gather a tenth so that we can provide for those who are not able to provide for themselves. Right? Now, what does tithing achieve? Right, what does tithing achieve? From a practical point of view, right? The first tithe that was commanded, it took care of those who are serving the Lord first time, for full time. For the second tithe, you take care of yourself. Right? We do need a break, right? God commands a Sabbath. God also commands this time of the feast where you put everything down and travel to Jerusalem, take a break, and know that the Lord is God. The third tithe, practically speaking, takes care of those who can't take care of themselves, right? Spiritually speaking, though, we need to have a very concrete reminder that everything that we have belongs to God, right? And I think all of us this morning here, I hope you wouldn't argue with me if I said everything that you have belongs to the Lord. It does, right? I think all of us would say, okay, you're right, Jason, you're right. Right? But we forget. We are a very forgetful people, which is why we have the Lord's Supper every week, because we forget what Jesus did. We have tithes instituted because we are forgetful people. If we really believe that everything we have belongs to the Lord, then really we should be able to take everything we have and give it to the Lord, right? But God's mandate is that we only give one-tenth because He does desire to provide for our sustenance. If we gave everything, right? If these Israelites gave everything they had, all their grain, all their animals, they wouldn't have anything to live off of, right? So God said, live off of what I give you, but as a reminder, so that you remember, I am going to require it of you, not because God needs money, right? And I've heard people say, you know, God doesn't need money, so I don't need to give. You're not giving because God needs anything, right? God instituted this for our own good. And the way I kind of see it is, imagine if I came to your house to visit, and I said, you know, hey, it's good to see you, Jay. And I came and I said, here's a pie for you. A slice is missing, right? And you might open and say, he took a slice, or what kind of guest is this, right? But it is a clear reminder that whenever you open that tin, this was someone else's pie. Somebody else brought it. It belonged to someone else, right? It's given to me, but that missing piece is a reminder of who it came from. And I think this is the way the tithes work, right? When we give all we have, that missing part is a reminder to us that this was all God's, because it's easy to keep it all and say, God, thank you, this all belongs to you. And then it just becomes lip service and we forget. And we say it, but we don't really feel it. But once we are able to give of what we have, God says He commands it so that we don't forget where all that we have comes from. And, you know, once someone has taken a piece of your pie, then it's not as hard to give of the rest of it, right? We actually become a little less greedy. God commands to tithe for our own good and for the good of others. Now, here's the question then. What happens if we don't tithe? Well, then you can't come to church anymore. No, your salvation, coming to church, being a part of the body, has nothing to do with whether or not you tithe. But God does speak about what he feels about people who don't tithe. Turn with me to the book of Malachi. Remember, we were studying about John the Baptist, right? And as part of that study, we looked at the prophet Malachi, who was giving a prophecy about John the Baptist. And remember what we said? Malachi's prophecy came at a time when Israel was in really bad shape. Right? Remember, after Malachi spoke, for 400 years, God was silent. Right? Israelites were in a bad shape. Turn with me, Malachi chapter 3, to see in this prophecy what God said about them. Malachi chapter 3, verse 7. Yet from the days of your fathers you have gone away from my ordinances and have not kept them. Return to me and I will return to you, said the Lord of hosts. So God starts this section. He says, you have been astray. You have not followed what I commanded. My laws, you're not following them. Return to me. God is saying, come back to me. Come back to me and I'll return to you. And the people of Israel, look how they responded. But you said, in what way shall we return? You know, what are we supposed to do to return, right? God in verse 8 says, will a man rob God? Yet you have robbed me. But you say, in what way have we robbed you? Right? So God is saying, you've robbed me. This is one way I want you to change your ways. You've robbed me. And people said, how do we rob you? How do we rob you, God? We can't access the stores of heaven and take from what you have, right? God responds in tithes and offerings, right? And here's the thing. What God says, when you don't tithe, when you don't offer, what you are doing is you are robbing God. And this is such a weird concept. It's always been a weird concept. And it's still a weird concept for me to wrap my mind around, because God, like I said, he doesn't lack anything, right? We can't really steal from God, right? How do we steal? He has everything, right? In the end, it all goes back to him anyways. How do we rob him? Do you think God somehow is going to have to lower his living standards if we don't give? No, it's not like that. It's not about God's needs or wants. He made everything. Everything's his already. When we don't tithe, when we don't offer, right, the reason why God says we rob God is because we are keeping for ourselves something that God has already commanded belongs to him. Not out of need, but because it's for our own good. But because we're not following that command, we are keeping back something that God says is rightfully his. Not because he needs it, not because he wants it, but because it is his law. Simple as that. It is black and white. God commanded it. It needs to be given. You didn't give it, and so you are robbing from him, right? What does God say about robbing? Okay. Now he says here that the reason we're looking at this passage today, right? Last week we saw three times the devil tempted Jesus, and during the Bible study we were talking about how Jesus reacts to the temptations, and one of the things we examined was these temptations. These temptations that Satan uses to knock Jesus off course, they are all centered on one thing. Jesus has one goal, God has prescribed the path, and what Satan offered was a shortcut. Right? Taking the shortcut, finding a way to circumvent God's will. Jesus, put your own will into play. You have the power, you have the authority to make things happen more quickly, and so do it. And so. There's shortcuts that were offered, right? You're hungry, Jesus. God was going to send his angels to minister to Jesus, and we see it happen at the end of the temptations. But the temptation was, take a shortcut. Turn these stones to bread, right? In time, Jesus will be revealed as a Messiah. But the shortcut, Satan said, was, you know what, get on top of that temple and jump. And when God's angels catch you, everyone that's here in the temple will see that you are Messiah, right? Take a shortcut, reveal yourself, right? In time, all the glory in this earth, every knee will bow, every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. All the glory belongs to Jesus at the end of days. And Satan says, we'll take a shortcut. Bow down and worship me, and all this will be yours. All this will be yours. And so, shortcut after shortcut, God's promise to us is, I will provide for you, but you need to remember that I gave you all that you have. And our shortcut is, you know what, God provides for me, yes, but you know what, that extra tenth surely could go a little bit farther in providing for my needs. If not for today, then for tomorrow, just in case God's provision doesn't come through. Right? Again, our trust falls through, or we start to take a shortcut, or we want to have more than what God has provided. And so we take that shortcut, right? Not our temptation in life always is to take a shortcut. I want to be gratified now. I want to have something now. I can't wait for the promise. And here in Malachi, God speaks to the prophet and he says, in disobeying God and in taking your own shortcuts, we are robbing God. But God's speaking to the Israelites, not because he wants to curse them. God is speaking this to the Israelites through Malachi because he wants to bless them. Look at verse 9. You are cursed with a curse, for you have robbed me, even this whole nation. This is what has already happened. They are already cursed. But God says in verse 10, Malachi 3:10, bring all the tithes into the storehouse, what you were supposed to give. Bring that into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house, and try me now in this, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open for you the windows of heaven and pour out for you such blessings that there will not be room enough to receive it. God says, try me. If you think keeping that one tenth is going to get you a little further, try me. Bring what you were supposed to bring and see that I don't open the heavens and bless you with so much that you don't even have room to hold what I've given you. Right? Jesus said, you shall not tempt the Lord your God. And so we talked about this passage a little bit on Monday at the men's Bible study. Don't put the Lord your God to the test. And the question that was brought up is, well, here God says, try me. Here God says, test me. Right? There is a difference. God here is not saying, test me. God here is saying, I have a command, and with this command comes a promise. Do what I command and see that I am true and that this promise will be fulfilled. Do what I commanded and experience the blessing. That's not testing God. That's simply following what God has said and seeing his promise fulfilled, right? And so God says, you've robbed me by not bringing your tithes. Well, do what you're supposed to do. Try it. Just try it. Do what you were supposed to do and see that I don't take care of you much more abundantly than what you have given. And so this is God's promise. He wants to bless us. There are blessings in store for us when we give. Right? God's saying here, not test me, but do what I command and be ready to receive the blessings that I have in store for you. You don't believe it? Try it. Right? Alice's mom, I've shared this story before. It's an awesome, awesome testimony. Alice's mom, they were ministers and they lived on a very strict budget. She had a small amount of money she had been saving because she needed to make a new dress. I think she was pregnant at the time and, you know, her dresses weren't fitting anymore. She needed to buy a cloth to make a new dress. And she had been saving up a little bit of money. One day, Alice's dad comes home, you know, typical pastor. A brother in church has a need. Give me the money that we've been saving. But I need it. The Lord needs it, okay? So Alice's mom hands the money over and he takes it and she's thinking, you know, I need to be faithful to God, but now I have no dress, right? A few days later, you guys remember, a few days later, a parcel shows up on their doorsteps. A bundle of cloth finer than anything she could have ever afforded. Because a gentleman somewhere said, I don't know why, but God said, give this cloth to Mrs. Z, right? When you give, the Lord blesses you much more abundantly than you can ever dream of in return. Now, there's questions then about giving, right? How much will I get back in return for giving? I hear this sometimes. You know what? It's not about measuring what you get back, right? You hear the story. So if I give money that I had been saving for buying a dress, then I'll get a much better dress. It doesn't work like that. Right? There's not a formula that we follow where you put in 10 and you get back 30. Yes, God says, test me and see that I don't bless you more abundantly. He has his own ways of blessing you. You don't know what it is. And there's not a formula. And here's the thing. Yes, God promises an incredible ROI, right? A return on investment. But if you're going to sit there and try to figure out a formula for your return on investment, then I think your heart's in the wrong place for why you're giving. Right? We give not because we are expecting something back in return. Right, so the first thing is, you want to make sure that your heart's in the right place when you give. It's not about figuring out what you're going to get back in return. Second question I hear sometimes, and this is a very real question, well, what about your tax deductions, right? For when you give, and the church records how much is received, if you give them the check or if you write your name on the envelopes, the church records these things, and at the end of the year, the church sends out a letter documenting what you have given, and with that letter, you can deduct this from your income. And there is benefit for that. With the recent tax laws, the increasing what couples would or people would get in their deductions, there is a worry that people would not give us much anymore because they're going to get even more deductions than their standard deductions. You know what? Tax deductions, whether or not you get them, it's a nice benefit to have. If you don't get it, I hope that's not why you're giving in the first place. Again, you're not giving for benefits, right? If the government happens to have laws set in place where you can get a tax break because you gave, then great, all the better. But I hope that that's not why we're giving, okay? How much, I get asked sometimes, how much should I give? You know what, we're no longer under the law of giving a tithe or a tenth, right? For me personally, right, this is my personal guideline, but this is not what God says. For me personally, I like to start with a tenth and to go up from there. But God in the New Testament does not give us an amount that we have to give. Right, so you're free from a numerical obligation. How much should you give, though, is still a real question, and that's a question you ask God. Right, you ask God, you give as you are able to give. I really do not suggest going into debt just for the sake of giving. Give as you are able, give of what you have. Notice the principle of tithes is give one-tenth of your gains. Right, so for someone who is not employed, who is not receiving income, I would say, I don't think you should be giving, unless the Lord speaks to you in a very clear way and says you need to give this amount at this time. I am not going to dispute what God says to you, but as a general principle, you give of your gains. If you're not gainfully employed, then you know what? God understands, right? If you're employed, how much do you give, right? The question I hear sometimes is, do I give? You know, if I want to give a tenth, do I give a tenth of my pre-tax dollars or after-tax dollars? And the response I always hear is, do you want pre-tax blessings or after-tax blessings? It doesn't really matter. You figure it out with God, what you feel you should give. That's between you and God, right? You know, the principle of tithing, right? If you're not, again, like I said, if you're not in a financial position to give, then don't give. My kids, I give them money so they can tithe because they're not making money. They don't get an allowance. It's not that terrible, they live well. They don't get an allowance, so they don't really have income to give of, right? So I make sure they have money because I want them to establish that habit of tithing, of giving something. That's how I was raised, right? As a little kid, I had a little canister in the kitchen, in a drawer, a little Swiss coffee canister that was empty, and it was stuffed with dollar bills. My grandma made sure it was always stuffed. And she said, every Sunday morning, make sure you take a dollar from there. Make sure every single Sunday you do this. You memorize, right? I have these muscles now. I have these muscle memories of taking that dollar, putting it in my pocket, giving it to church, and putting it in, right? It's a part of who I am. Now it's more than a dollar, but I had that habit established since I was a young child. And so those of you that are not yet parents, when you have kids, I hope you establish a good habit for them. Teach them young, right? And again, don't give beyond what you can unless God specifically calls you to. If God calls you to do something that puts you in tremendous hardship, then you know what? Maybe you're hearing wrong. Don't give out of guilt either, right? A good brother shared on Monday that he used to give more out of guilt and to compensate for other areas in his life that were not going as well spiritually. Don't do that. You know, we're not here to sell penance. Right, giving more is not going to cancel out your sin debts or whatnot. Give as the Lord leads you to give. How often should I give is another question I get sometimes. You know, I know some people who will give once a lump sum at the beginning of the year. Some people will give once at the end of the year. This is not a biblical command, but my own principle that helps me in my walk with the Lord is I give whenever I receive. Because I don't know what my year will look like, so it's hard to figure out at the beginning of the year. And if I wait until the end of the year, well, then I have not been in the habit of giving, right? And I like to be in the habit of giving regularly. As I receive, it's very easy. As I receive, a tenth goes to the Lord right away. And again, it's not about the numbers, but that frequency, it helps me to remember, because I am a very forgetful person, and the older I'm getting, the more I forget. This act of giving helps remind me every time that it happens, Lord, everything I have is yours. And right from the top, I'm going to set a part aside so that I remember that this is yours. It's a constant reminder that what I have is not my own. Now that's a lot. I think it's a lot to share all at once on the topic of tithing and offering. And if you want to review any of this information, you know, we'll have the video up online and the audio recording by tomorrow. I had hoped to look in more detail at 2 Corinthians chapter 9. So on your own time, perhaps, go and read it. It is a good chapter on the attitudes of giving that Paul writes. But I do want to call out two things from this chapter. 2 Corinthians, we can turn there. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, I want to read verses 6 to 8. When you get there, read along with me. This is Paul. He says, This I say, he who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and he who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. So let each one give as he purposes in his heart, that's between you and God, not grudgingly or of necessity, not because you feel like you have to, but with a glad heart, for God loves what? A cheerful giver. I hope when you tithe and when you offer, as your fingers release that money that you have trouble letting go of, that it brings a smile to your face. It should. God loves a cheerful giver. Verse 8, and God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that you, always having all sufficiency in all things, may have an abundance for every good work. As you give, God will give you more so that you're able to give more, so that there will be an abundance in the work of the Lord. Right? God does not shortchange us. God does not make us suffer. But God wants us to remember, whose was it all anyways? It was His. And I want to leave you with one last thought. If anything else, this is a thought that we should always have when we prayerfully give. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 15. Thanks be to God for His indescribable gift. Thanks be to God for His indescribable gift. As I give, I understand this was a gift from the Lord to begin with. Thank you, God, for your indescribable gift. Here's my reminder to myself that it came from you. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Jesus, I thank you, Lord, that we live by your providence. I thank you, Lord, that in your mercy you have commanded, Lord, that we ought to give. And so I pray that you would lead each and every one of us, Lord, to that right relationship with you in giving. Not because you have need, but because we have need, Lord. We have need to be set free from the hold that our finances have over us. Help us, Lord, to find freedom in giving so that we are able to say, Lord, it was all yours to begin with. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.